Today, I'd like to talk about how do we do a year-end money management review. So why do we need to do a review? The reason we need to do a review because we want to know whether we are on track, you know, as far as our achievement of financial freedom goes. Okay? Of course, in the beginning of the year, we set all kinds of goals. You know, we want to achieve this, we want to do that. But the point is, at the end of the year, are we really doing it? You know? And we need to face the moment of truth. So basically today, I have got six checkpoints to share, basically which actually include number one, saving. So we need to know, say for example, the saving that we set in the beginning of the year is we want to achieve, say, 30,000 in the beginning. We need to check at the end of the year, are we really achieving it? Whether you're achieving 20,000 or 40,000. So we need to know whether you actually achieve your saving target. Now, if you underachieve it, at least we need to know why you're underachieving it. Whether it's because you do not have budget for your spending, or you have unexpected, you know, major expenses that come, or you may actually discover that you actually earn less than what you actually expected. So knowing all these reasons will help you to form important information for you to plan for next year. The second actually checkpoint is about the investment performance. Okay, under investment performance, we want to look at two main areas. Number one is the actual capital gain. Number two is about the rental gain. Number one, actual capital gain. Say for example, at the beginning of the year, you plan to actually invest into unit trust and then you expect to achieve 8% return. And the point is that at the end of the year, whether your particular investment actually giving you 8% return or not. So if it does achieve, say 10-12%, congratulations, you've done a good job. But what if the investment that you actually done is giving you only 4%, 3%, or worse still, even losing money? So in this case, what you need to do is to look at what is causing the losing money part and find out whether how does this particular fund compare to a peers. For example, this is an Equity Malaysia fund. You will compare with other Equity Malaysia fund to see how is it performing. If it's actually other Equity Malaysia fund all doing very well and your only Equity Malaysia fund doing very poorly, then I think you need to do something about that. Number two, you talk about actual rental gain. So if you, for example, at the beginning, you've got three pieces of properties and you target to have 70,000 rental income. Okay, at the end of the year, do you or did you manage to collect 70,000 rental income? So if you did, then congratulations again, you are on track. But if you're only collecting maybe 30,000 rental income because one of piece of the property actually got cut the renter or you didn't manage to rent it out, then you need to figure out what you need to do with that particular piece of property, whether you're getting the right renter that's matched with the market rate or you're actually not doing enough work on that. Third checkpoint is talking about debt management. When you look at debt management, we look at your current debt to asset ratio. How do you get the ratio? Basically, is that you have a total debt divided by total assets. If you discover your debt to asset ratio actually is more than 70%, then you have a major problem. No? Because then you have actually too much debt and you have problem actually solving that. But if you actually debt ratio actually is only say 30%, then you meaning that you're in a healthy condition. So if you find that your debt to asset ratio is too high, say 70%, you may want to find out what are the major contributors. Whether number one is because of your property loan, number two could be your car loan, or could be your credit card loans. For example, if you find that your property loan is too much, okay, actually contributing to maybe 50% or 60% of your whole asset, then you may want to actually set a goal of next year to cut down some of the property so that you have a less debt exposure. The fourth checkpoint we talk about here is insurance planning. So a lot of time when we actually start at the beginning of the year, we may say that we want to actually cover ourselves sufficiently, whether in the area of death, disability, or critical illness. Okay? So what we want to actually find out is that in the beginning, for example, you actually intend to actually cover yourself for 100,000 for critical illness, but your current coverage is only 30,000. What you want to do is to make sure that at the end of the year, to review whether you have actually covered yourself for 100,000. If you have not covered yourself for 100,000 before the year end, you may want to actually goal to actually get some insurance coverage to increase your coverage to the ideal level to provide the sufficient coverage to your own family. Now, of course, when it comes to actually insurance planning, we must not forget about the beneficiary domination. Okay, we want to make sure that the nomination of the beneficiary, you have got the name inside there, whether it's your spouse, whether it's your parents, whether your children, are still the name that you want to name as a beneficiary. Next, the fifth checkpoint, we're talking about EPF. Okay, we're talking about EPF nomination here. We're talking about here whether the beneficiary that you name in the EPF are the beneficiary that you still want to name. Okay, you want to make sure that beneficiary that you name for your EPF, okay, are the people that you really want to actually cover. Okay, should something happen to you, the EPF money go to the person. What you do not want to find is that you have a girlfriend, ex-girlfriend's name inside there, okay, or you have some beneficiary who already passed away, still actually having the name as an EPF nomination. So I will urge you to look at your EPF, okay, nominations and do a new fresh nomination. The sixth checkpoint we talk about here is talking about the will. No, we're talking about whether the executor or the guardian that you appointed are still a valid person that you want to actually appoint. You want to check whether the executor and the guardian, whether they are still alive, living, whether they are still healthy, and also whether they're still in good relationship with you to do the job of taking care of children in the event of your absence. Of course, not forgetting, you want to actually review the beneficiary. So you want to see that these are the beneficiary that you still want to benefit them. You want to review whether you're giving them the same percentage that you want. Say, for example, you want to give the wife 40%, the children, say three children, 20% each. Or you want to change the percentage in such a way that the wife may end up having 60% and the children, three children, sharing the 40% the balance. And another point is talking about here is distribution method. Whether you want the children to receive everything they have to be benefit at the age of 18 years old at one go, or you want to actually stagger it to say 50% at 18 years old and then another 50% at 25 years old after their university graduation. So I also always want to actually emphasize that when you do not do review, it's very difficult for you to expect result for your money management. So always remember, smarter you, smarter money management. This is what I have to share with you today. Over back to you, Joanne. Sorry, joining today is not around. Aisha is here and today. Hanson. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
I think Yao was referring to me as Joanne.
Yeah, you look a bit like Joanne today.
Yeah, okay, you know.
Especially your hair.
Anyway, thank you for that very informative point. You know, I always like the fact that you have very clear, concise point form. So it's very easy, I think, for everyone to sort of follow. But coming back to, so this is more about reviewing, like how, say, a company would review their past performance, so to speak. Okay.
Mm. Now it's also like for example, every year we go and do medical checkup to know our blood pressures, to know whether our this sugar levels, you know, our cholesterol level. The same thing also come to money management. We also to know that our saving, whether we are achieving it, whether our ROI, whether we are hitting the target we want, our coverage and things like that. So it's the same analogy.
Now companies would have certain documents like, you know, a balance sheet, a P&L or income statement for them to be able to track the performance of every single product. But, you know, would you advise for an individual, especially if you do have, let's just say, for instance, you've got your investments, you've got your property, you've got EPF and all that. How would you be able to track it, let's just say? Would you suggest individuals like to come up with a document like a
PowerPoint or something or a Word or Excel document?
That's actually a very good suggestion. Yeah. Basically, is that it's exactly the same. When it comes to a DJ managing the finance of the company, basically the same DJ plan come to managing the individual. The two very important documents that we need to come out when we actually do our year-end review. Number one is to do our income and expenses statement. So you have a list of all your income that you received this year versus all the expenses that you have. Then you know whether you're positive or negative. So the second important document we're going to talk about here is about balance sheet. This company, all the assets that you have got at one side, and all the loan, credit card, all the debts you have on the other side. So then you know whether you have positive net worth or you're actually negative.
Still in negative. But it's always being like you know, having credit or in debt is always a bad thing. Is it always a bad thing?
I would say that actually having credit or having actually liability or loan does not necessarily mean the very bad thing.
Right, you know?
I would suggest to take a moderate or middle path approach.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, some people say, oh, actually, I want to just take risks, I want to grow my wealth, so I want to get maximum 90% or maybe 85% loan exposure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That, I would think, would be very risky.
Right.
Especially, you know, when actually you invest in the property, you may not be getting enough cash flow to service the loan.
Right.
But neither do I suggest to say, cut all your loan. You know, another extreme to say, cut all the loan.
It's impossible in this day and age, right?
It's not to say impossible. There are people who are so thrifty, they have all the saving. Whenever they got saving, they want to settle
cash.
The loan.
Yeah.
Right.
You know?
But the point is that then you're not doing leveraging.
Yeah.
So my suggestion is always that if you have 20, 30 or 40% loan exposure, that's fine.
Yeah.
You're the best of the both.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
Okay, now we're heading to the new year next week, actually.
Mm.
So maybe you could help give our viewers some really good tips on how to have achievable...